everyone. Thanks for having me. I'll be talking about surgery. I'll acknowledge my biases up front as one of those who performs the surgeries, but happy to talk about all the details of surgery itself. As we've discussed thus far, it really depends where you are on the risk spectrum when we talk about where surgery plays in the treatment paradigm for prostate cancer. I picked out some of my favorites up here. Ignore my own picture, that's a little weird. But for those who have prostate cancer that's contained within the prostate, surgery remains a good option. And really, as discussed before, when we discuss risk, that's when we need to talk about our treatment options. What are the best options for you to get not only the best outcome, but minimize comorbidities? Obviously, any treatment has a risk of causing some impairment in quality of life, time away from work, responsibilities, impact on function, and that needs to be part of the discussion, not just the PSA that comes after the treatment. Where is the prostate, or more often called the prostrate, especially at the VA? It sits in between the bladder and the inside of the penis called the urethra. So it sits right there, fused with both. And the prostatectomy is the way that we surgically remove it, prostate and seminal vesicles, from the prostate and the urethra, and then reattach those areas together. Now that ends up being obviously a change in your anatomy. And that proportion of the urethra that is removed has to be made up in terms of the gap. So we have to bring the bladder down to the urethra, complete that reconnection of the plumbing, if you will. And often when we talk about surgery, there's a question of whether or not we just remove the prostate and the seminal vesicles at the backside of the prostate, or if we need to remove the lymph nodes around the prostate as well. And that's really part of the discussion that's informed not only by your biopsy, your PSAs, and your risk stratification, but also all the imaging we discussed as well, or MRI, PSMA PET. All of that goes into that discussion. Now, how do we do prostatectomies today? You know, oftentimes we tell everyone we do it robotically, laparoscopic, and I have to always warn everyone, we're not at the phase yet where the robot is doing the work. It's merely a tool. So we still have a job for the time being. Now we do this through a large apparatus that looks almost like a spider on the left side. The robot allows us to control these arms and perform this large surgery through small incisions. That laparoscopic approach has been shown to clearly help in terms of recovery and time afterwards. I always have to remind people that even though their incisions are small and they're going home the next day, or in some cases the same day, they still had a large operation. So we have to kind of remind them of the fact that they are going to be recovering from that. Those small incisions, again, allow us to have much better improved return of function and recovery and pain management, time to get home rather than staying in the hospital for hours. What is involved? We talked about this a little bit. Again, removing the prostate from where it sits not only means detaching it from the bladder and the urethra, but also the nerves and the blood vessels that provide nutrition and oxygen and blood to the prostate and surrounding areas. And throughout the surgery itself, this is where we're monitoring the risk of bleeding. If there's bleeding, we're able to stop it surgically. Understanding that the prostate does not sit by itself in a large empty space, but it's surrounded by other organs, other vessels. And part of the discussion when we talk about prostatectomy and that surgery is the risk of injury to those other things. Again, informed by our imaging, our assessments prior to the operation itself. And for most men, this requires just 23 hours in the hospital, basically going home the next day, making sure you're comfortable as well as your family are comfortable with the nice thick packet of reading material we give you before you go home. Now, because we're detaching the prostate from the bladder and making a reconnection, that connection has to heal. And we don't want that connection bathed in urine the entire time. So that's why we leave that Foley catheter in place or the tube going through the penis. Now, I tell everyone, you may not actually know who's had treatment or not because all of that hides underneath your clothes. So people are not tethered with this long tube. They're actually able to be functional and work around. But I do warn people not to lift any trucks or boulders for at least 4 weeks after surgery to allow all those incisions to heal. Now, why choose prostatectomy? A lot of this depends, again, on clinical risk and the workup that's done prior to treatment. So after diagnosis, that thorough discussion of everything that we've done thus far, also incorporating your preferences and concerns. Now, surgery in and of itself is often framed as kind of a one and done. Patients always ask me, well, if I have surgery, then I'm fine, I don't have to worry. But after surgery itself, we need to really understand what's happening. Part of the prostatectomy is the treatment afterwards, monitoring the PSA, which is now a good measure of the disease burden that hopefully is not there. The goal being to remove all of the cancer, the PSA be undetectable or as close as we can legally say to zero within 6 to 8 weeks after surgery. If the PSA rises afterwards, then we know that there's a concern for recurrence, and that becomes a discussion of what, how to best treat that, how to identify the area or source of the PSA. That is really based on our surgical pathology in that PSA. And for many men, surgery is the best option, particularly in higher risk disease. And discussion of that is always a heated topic between the surgery side and my radiation colleagues. But right. No, it's always fun. Yeah. Always cheer for it. And men who have larger prostates, the surgery itself may actually serve two purposes, both removing the obstruction. Are these automated times? Okay. Removing the obstruction itself, as well as removing the cancer. So again, that is tailoring the treatment to your specific condition and setting, is always part of the discussion for prostate. So why not choose prostatectomy? I guess now it's not time. Okay. So when we discuss prostatectomy, it all depends again on where this person is in their risks or concerns. There is a risk of incontinence or urine leakage after surgery. Your body just underwent a large anatomic change and now has to recover. Oftentimes this impacts not only the bladder, the urethra, the sphincter, the control mechanism right where we did the surgery, but the area around it. And that takes time to recover. And this is where we talk about after the surgery itself, men having to kind of retrain the area and recover and gain that urine control afterwards. And that's where we talk about urinary pads being needed, especially if men are lifting, golfing, doing some other activity, managing that for them as part of the continued care after the surgery. Incontinence is not something that happens at one time, but an improvement over time. And we work with you after that constantly to make sure we understand how you're improving. And we know, looking at our own data, that men will become continent at over time, 12 months or even beyond, in that some men may just need a precautionary pad. Now, there are cases, and we tailor that based on each individual who may be at higher risk of that and how to support them afterwards as well. And that's where it really comes down to patient preference and considerations of the surgery. We know that the rates of incontinence can range dramatically. And this is where really, when we look at national data or large cohorts, we have these reported rates, but it's really tailoring based on the experience of UCSF and what we've experienced here. And understanding that people who have more significant leakage over time, we can support them with that as well. So it's not a one-time suffer in silence type of thing. Thank you, Matt, for the slide in the picture for this one. But something that evolves over time, and we support you throughout that evolution. Now, erectile dysfunction, this is another aspect. I tell everyone things will not get better than they were during surgery. But the question is, how can we support you as this recovers over time as well? And oftentimes, nerve sparing when patients see me is often discussed as either all or nothing. And it's really a grade. And all of the imaging helps us understand how close we can get to the prostate and not leave prostate cancer behind, but also spare a lot of the nerves that are running on the outer portion, lateral aspect of the prostate. And most men will experience some change as we remove the prostate from the nerves that were connected to it. And then we follow them over time to see how that those nerves recover and also how we can support them in terms of maintaining erectile dysfunction. And again, this is something that does not just stop at 6 weeks after surgery, but rather improves and progresses over time as well. So this is a continual process. And we discuss about how much of that recovery happens for each person based on where they started. So if people are using medicines beforehand, I would not expect them to not need any medicines afterwards. But how can we support them with other modalities to get them back to an area that they like? And thankfully now we've been expanding that support even further. So penile rehabilitation, we've always discussed medications and other strategies that we can use to improve recovery over time. And now we've even rolled out a better clinic to focus on that recovery by starting before surgery itself, supporting men through and then afterwards to improve these domains as well. Now, the other thing that we often talk about is, okay, what happens after the prostate's removed or the prostate, what did it do? Now, orgasm unchanged, but no fluid will come out at that time of ejaculation. So oftentimes that is a shocker, no matter how many times we say this to patients. So we always make sure that they're aware. And we discuss that fertility in the sense where sperm is often delivered through natural paths is now disrupted because the prostate has been disconnected. So we often talk about banking in advance or recovery later if desired. And again, now we've removed part of the prostate and part of the urethra and have to reconnect the plumbing, if you will. And some people will see shortening in the penis from us reconnecting that path to fill in the quote gap from where the prostate was. And that's something that we often discuss and monitor over time as well. Very much case dependent. And in some cases, there may be a discussion of where surgery and radiation fit into that paradigm. And we have to talk about in those cases, the sequence of those events and how that may impact not only the preoperative or surgical management, but also the long-term outcomes after those treatments. Now I would be, I made sure to at least include a few slides on how we're using PSMA PET intraoperative. And this is some work that's been led by Dr. Carroll, Hao Wen, and others in our group to make sure that we can use this even during the surgery itself. I often tell people, I can't see the margins at the same magnification that Dr. Ding can during the surgery. So are there other ways that we can identify where the tumor is or where tumors may be left, where cells may be left over to improve our margin rate? So getting all of the cancer out during the surgery itself. So this is an active area of research, which really helps us understand where there may be other areas of disease. In getting us closer and closer to using more of this intraoperatively, combining all of these modalities and technologies to provide better surgical management and surgical outcomes for our patients. We're not yet to the goggles, but one day, one day. Thank you.